it's harder to talk sense to people whose lives are slipping out of their control. I also think that culture and political economy move at different paces. Cultural shifts are slow and molecular. Changing people's minds is very hard. Max Planck, the great physicist, said that physics progresses one funeral at a time. Well, it's something like that is how cultures change. People with old ideas don't so much change their mind as disappear.
When Pressed Wafer first published George, Pressed Wafer was in Boston. And what happened is this. On a May day, when What Are Intellectuals Good For came out, I think it was a Thursday, 1,500 copies of the book arrived at 9 Columbus Square in Boston. And that very afternoon, a review appeared on NPR. So I didn't know it was coming. George didn't know it was coming. The truck, there's a glamour part of publishing to this. The truck dropped the cases off. I unloaded them, put them in the basement of 9 Columbus Square. The next day, the orders began coming in. I had to buy the George Scialabba Memorial two-wheeler. And by Monday, we were absolutely out of copies. Now, little did we imagine that George would be the perfect writer for our president-elect. George writes is a master of the 4-5-page essay review. What could be more perfect for a man who has said, this man, of course, is Donald J. Trump, that I don't read books, I read chapters. Randy Kennedy, who I've just met tonight and had met earlier in the day through an email, and George will shortly be talking after George reads something to get this started. And after they say a few words, I'll prime the pump, and then this will largely be your evening talking to them. I'm going to introduce both of them by reading a poem by Gary Snyder. I went into the Maverick Bar. I went into the Maverick Bar in Farmington, New Mexico, and drank double shots of bourbon, backed with beer. My long hair was tucked up under a cap. I'd left the earring in the car. Two cowboys did horseplay by the pool tables. A waitress asked us, "Where are you from?" A country and western band began to play, "We don't smoke marijuana in Muskogee." And with the next song, a couple began to dance. They held each other, like in high school dances in the 50s. I recalled when I worked in the woods and the bars of Madras, Oregon. That short-haired joy and roughness. America, your stupidity. I could almost love you again. We left onto the freeway shoulders, under the tough old stars, in the shadow of bluffs. I came back to myself, to the real work, to what is to be done. George Scialabba.
Can everyone hear? Thank you all for coming. Thanks to Bill Corbett for that extravagantly kind introduction. Bill is not only the CEO and janitor at Pressed Wafer, he is also the chief publicist, so you should take anything he says about me with a grain of salt. And thanks to Harvard Bookstore for making an exception to its usual practice of hosting America's most distinguished and popular writers in this series. Actually, that's only half true. Randall Kennedy's many books on race, politics, and the law, all of them on sale here at Harvard Bookstore, have made him one of Harvard's America's leading public intellectuals. After the trauma of the Great Depression, the New Deal reforms of the 1930s briefly civilized capitalism. For a few decades after World War II, unionized white workers did unprecedentedly well. Pensions and medical insurance, vacations, cost of living, and productivity escalators, credit unions and sick days, all that and more became the norm for a sizable segment of the American working class. The Indochina War, the OPEC oil embargo, and other costs of empire, along with the increasing competitiveness of Western Europe and Japan, put an end to this civilized interlude. American capitalism began to cannibalize itself in the 1980s, morphing from a manufacturing economy to a finance-based one. Individual plants and whole companies were sold off or drastically downsized, with the proceeds going to hedge funds or private equity firms, or else moved overseas to regions with cheap labor and few regulations. Technical innovation in business focused on cost-cutting measures, which usually meant fewer employees. Unionized jobs disappeared, government revenues plummeted, public services starved, and infrastructure decayed. Levels of median income, home ownership, public health, and educational performance all tanked. In nearly every measure of general welfare, the United States fell below nearly every other developed country. How have the authors of this catastrophe gotten away with it? Why is there so little organized resistance to plutocracy in this new Gilded Age? The most obvious reason is the decline of organized labor. This was not a spontaneous development. It was the primary element in spontaneous development. It was the primary element in business's strategy of rolling back the New Deal. In the wake of the civil rights movement of the 1960s, the Republican Party played the race card, inflaming resentment among Southern whites, which was a major obstacle to labor organizing there. A large-scale odyssey of manufacturing industry to the non-union Sunbelt followed. The Reagan administration began the now decades-long practice of stacking the National Labor Relations Board with anti-labor appointees determined not to enforce the Fair Labor Practices Act. And then came globalization. During the Cold War, the free world meant that part of the world in which American business could operate free of unruly unions or excessively welfare-minded governments. Democracy was unimportant to U.S. policymakers, except for public relations purposes. And communism simply meant unwillingness to provide a sufficiently favorable investment climate. When the Cold War ended, business rejoiced, not because people were liberated, but because capital was. A century after it was launched in the late 1800s, the open door policy triumphed on a global scale. One so-called free trade agreement after another has extended a common regime of investor rights worldwide, empowering debtors and sharply limiting the ability of workers or consumers to organize, and of states to tax, regulate, or provide essential services. In addition to gaining a stranglehold on economic life, business has undertaken a long march through the political landscape. Efficiency, incentives, personal responsibility, the ownership society, these and other slogans have served to disguise class warfare, a sustained assault on the income and security of the vast majority. Concentrating media ownership in a few giant corporations, slashing public funding for education at all levels, creating a cottage industry of junk science and dubious policy research, placing industry flacks at the head of regulatory agencies, packing the appellate judiciary with younger, less experienced, but rabidly partisan conservative judges, and most important, spending huge sums to elect friendly legislators and providing them with lucrative employment when they leave office these are the mechanisms of business hegemony in 21st century America. The resulting political system is a complex and intricate machine that wonderfully facilitates certain kinds of initiative, money-driven ones, while efficiently frustrating others, citizen-driven ones. It has been skillfully engineered to make fundamental change extremely difficult and to prevent our even imagining alternatives. The damage to individual lives and to our common life is inestimable. Something must be done. Knowing what to do is the easy part. Europe's economy is as efficient and innovative as America's, and its population has more leisure, job security, social supports, and quality health care. The U.S. could doubtless catch up by returning to the spirit of the New Deal. The steps are obvious. Restore progressive taxation, curtail tax evasion by the rich, sharply regulate the financial industry, extend Medicare to all, make public higher education free, reduce military spending, limit campaign contributions, link trade agreements to foreign labor rights, reform campaign finances, and appoint people to the Labor Department, FDA, HUD, EPA, SEC, and IRS, who want to achieve rather than frustrate the purposes of those agencies. If there is a will, these are the obvious ways. But where is the will? Where is our country's civic pride, its democratic honor? Why is American politics so far to the right, not only of European, but even of American public opinion? Why are our elected representatives so often corrupt mediocrities? What should one do when the best of one's fellow citizens lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity? I hope you all have some ideas.
I'll be happy to start the ball rolling. Just a couple things. First, in general, I feel terrible. Very despondent. It was notable that in your remarks you didn't mention the name Donald J. Trump, which I think is noteworthy because your remarks suggest that, you know, things weren't peachy keen in our country before a month ago. We were in trouble a month ago, but I will dare say that since then we're in even deeper trouble. And so one question that I'm going to have for you in a minute is, you know, what is to be done? How should people who are thoughtful, how should citizens, how should intellectuals, what should be our attitude in this moment? And what are concrete things that we can do? But I want to go back to this thing of feeling terrible, because I do, but I think it is important. I think at this very moment, in this very setting, we should, in this dark moment, treasure moments like this one. I mean, it's, you know, the fact of the matter is we are here. We're here in a wonderful place. For me, this is a home away from home. It's one of the pillars of our local political culture. It's a treasure, and I think we should be aware of that. And I am also, and that gives me pleasure and gives me hope. I also feel pleasure and hope being beside you and your work. We're here to celebrate your latest compilation of essays, but, you know, there are others as well, and congratulations for that. You're, you know, an encyclopedic reader. You think, you're careful, you're wide-ranging, you're bold. With all of that as the backdrop, I put your question to us back to you. In this particular moment, for people who want to be thoughtful and push our nation ahead in a good way, what are some suggestions that you might have?
Well, we got Trump because we're not good enough citizens. And we've just got to be better citizens. I suppose I would suggest 5 and 5. Devote 5 hours a week to doing something or other civic, even if it's just writing book reviews, or talking with the people at work. Just something that will strengthen the civic culture. And if you have specific skills and interests, join join local or national groups of whatever, scientists, lawyers, a good idea just swam into my head and then swam right out. It'll come back before the end of the evening. Anyway, the other 5 is give 5% of your disposable income. That's not your before-tax income. It's not even your after-tax income. It's your income after you've paid all the bills, the income you would spend going to the movies or going bowling, or not the money you would have spent buying books at Harvard Bookstore, which actually is a civic obligation, I suppose. So I guess we've got to start. I think, as you pointed out, I think the weaknesses, the defects in our political culture and our civic culture are pretty fundamental, long predated he who shall not be named, and unfortunately will last for a very long time, whether he's a one term, two term, or hopefully less than one term president. But we just have to start at the base, strengthening the political culture and civic culture, and that means just doing something. And first thinking about what to do, thinking about how your effort, your 5 hours and 5% can actually be linked with other people's 5 hours and 5%. Because this is not a healthy political culture. We don't have an informed, energized, self-confident citizenry. We wouldn't be wringing our hands to quite the same extent, but we wouldn't be, all that much better off, or at least it wouldn't be a fundamentally healthier political situation if Hillary Clinton had won not only the Electoral College vote, or rather, not only the popular vote, which ought to be what counts, though it doesn't. Begin at the base, I'd say, and just enough time, whether 5 hours or 4 or 10, that it costs a bit, and just enough support for whatever cause or organization seems best, that again, that costs a bit, and that. So that's
okay.
What is to be done?
One of the things I'll be doing is calling on people when you're about to engage in this, and let me offer you the few thoughts I have, because I think the battle's about to be joined. It's going to happen quickly. It's going to happen as soon as he gets inaugurated and he brings some of these extraordinary Paul Ryan people. Because I don't think Trump gives a rat's ass about the domestic agenda. He wants the bigger stage. And it's going to come when Price is nominated for the health care position. It's going to come. The three Ps, the EPA and Pruitt. We're going to see what our senators are like. And the guy who's going to head labor, the hamburger magnate. Another thing we've got to start thinking of, and we've got to think of this in the context and remember that Newt Gingrich in 1994, when those guys won and Rush Limbaugh rushed into the city and said, you know, we're here. 3 years later, Gingrich was out on his ass, Jack Abramoff was on his way to jail, and Tom DeLay, the hammer, was close to being in jail. These people fall too. They make mistakes. This is not all there is. But I'm thinking of 2020, the governorships, the state legislature, clearly the way in which we were bad citizens was we didn't do anything about those. There was a great sleepathon going on in this country. And voter suppression. Those things have to be dealt with. I don't know how, but what I'm offering is areas where we could. And the Democratic National Committee has to be run. I don't know whether it's Ellison, but if they can do it, we can do it. And it's been done before. So when I think of answers, I think of those as the areas we're going to have to work in. I now live in Brooklyn, and I fully expect to be in front of Trump Tower, where about 3 days after his election, I had drinks with a guy. It's right across from 724 Fifth Avenue, which is a building of art galleries. De Bordonnage on the top and Phil Alexander's gallery on the fourth floor. We were sitting there having a drink, looking across at this. The streets shut off when we hear in a gravelly, guttural voice, "Grab my pussy! This pussy grabs back!" And we look out, and there's a woman, she was about 60, standing there screaming this, and the cops saying, "Oh, no, no, please, lady, move on. And I fully expect to be standing there one day chanting with an enormous number of people, "Lock him up." Meaning, I think it's going to turn. I don't know when. I don't know how. George has given you his sense. Or started it off. Randy's got something to say, and then we'll open it up to you, and I'll be picking people out of the crowd.
Okay? I just remembered, actually, the good idea that swam into my head and then swam out. It's how did the Tea Party do it? They did it by taking over the Republican Party at the grassroots, at the local level, by winning municipal elections, by winning state legislatures, and then, of course, gerrymandering the hell out of congressional districts. So, I don't know, third parties, dicey, but whether or not we really should start contesting control of the Democratic Party. So that's a good project for, and as for, Bill mentioned, demonstrations. I'm ambivalent about demonstrations, partly because I'm lazy, and you know, standing out in the cold is also, as you've noticed, a rather frail voice, and I can only yell for about 5 minutes at a time. But also because demonstrations leave no institutional, organizational residue. And that's essential. They have, you know, they organized up the wazoo from the Business Roundtable and the U.S. Chamber of Commerce right down to the local Tea Party chapter. And, you know, we have to match that. So million-person demonstrations are great, but if you have a choice between, you know, a commitment to keeping some organization going, however humble, at however low a level, and just adding your body and voice to a demonstration, then
it's not either or.
Both and. Yes, sure.
And I'm suggesting that he get, because I think this man has an ego such as we know that when he begins to get a little dose of his own medicine, he opens up avenues for other possibilities. But Randy, you were going to say?
I would like to turn things up to the over to the audience. I'd like to hear questions, comments, and by all means, objections.
Let me hear something from Jen.
So the way I look at it, the Democratic Party forgot about class. It became the victim Olympics where everybody has a, you know, something they want a special deal about. And they became more concerned with transgender bathrooms than what was happening to the guys out in the Rust Belt. I drove through the Rust Belt a million times over the last 20 years. I had a trip I had to take from Boston to Columbus, Ohio, I don't know, 20 or 30 times. And I would get out of the car and I'd look around. Everything was closed. There were junkies. And I was saying, what the hell's going on? And they're flying over this stuff and they're not seeing what was really going on. But they were concerned about a laundry list of things that was important to urban Democrats, but they didn't understand these. These people are very different. They're religious. They have, you know, they go to church. They talk about Jesus all the time, you know? And it's a whole different world. And they were ignored and called deplorables and put down. And this was the bedrock of the Democratic Party, for God's sakes, in the 30s. They were worried about Pennsylvania. They were worried about Ohio. They were worried about upstate New York. They were worried about these. Now they can go jump in a lake, and they didn't pay off the losers. And the losers are in that part of the country. And if you don't pay off the losers, they're going to come to get you. And that's exactly what's happening now. And I don't think anybody here understands how serious it is, because I'll bet almost nobody here knows, has gotten in a car and rolled through that area.
George?
Will, how do those of us in deep blue areas like this, I mean, what should we do? I agree, basically. What should people in, you know, where do we start? What do we do with that comment of yours?
Well, you gotta pay off the losers. You can't just let them sit there and rot. And, you know, the other day I was talking about guys in Ohio and these other places, and they said, well, they're white, they can move to the city and be Uber drivers. And I said, hello, you've been living in Eastern Kentucky for 100 years, and you're just going to drop everything and go to New York City and become an Uber driver. That's not going to happen. And so you've got to pay them off where they are. You've got to create something. You can't just
I'd like to say something nothing, in response, because you know? I guess I agree with some but disagree very strongly with others. First, with respect to some of the issues that it seemed to me you were making light of on the cultural front, I think it's a great thing that a lot of people have made it their business to stand up for people who are trans people, gay people, lesbian people. You know, there's some people who would say, well, you know, those are sort of minor concerns. I don't view them as minor concerns. I think you view them as very serious concerns. And I think it's very good that people with a progressive impulse have spent energy and time and effort on, you know, those elements of our political culture. As for the people that you mentioned the word deplorable. Some of those people are deplorable. Absolutely. I sympathize for them. I empathize with them. I'm sorry that they are miserable and have allowed their misery to be,
to be, I'm sorry that they have allowed themselves to be tricked and put somebody in power who's going to make them more miserable. But if they are racist, which some of them are, not all, but some of them are, if they are saying to people, no Muslims allowed, if they are saying, you know, gay people be damned, if they are saying deplorable things, they are deplorable. And I don't think anybody should be at all apologetic about saying that. You can say that and also say, I sympathize with them. I want them to have a better life too, so they won't make such a damn fool of themselves by putting Donald J. Trump in charge of our country. So, you know, this deplorables, a lot of these people are deplorable. Fine. Oh, God, I don't know what that means. If you have a disagreement,
we'll get to
the floor is open.
But something that ought to be remembered.
Oh, he's going. So I think we've said enough about that. Except we ought to remember that Mike Pence, who was the person who was willing to keep people out of bathrooms, had to have his head turned by things like the National Basketball Association, which decided, we're not going to play in your city. He brought down upon himself an enormous storm. All right, so now he's president. Well, obviously I'm on your side in this. Fred, what do you got to say?
Well, a lot of people have asked that question, that very question, George, and there's two global meta-theories. One has to do with economics. The 50 years from 1940 to 1970 were truly an amazing 30 years. Were truly an amazing period of time, and we haven't had anything much like that since. So that's one theory. The economy has just stagnated. The other theory has to do with the passing of, it has to do with the white theory. It's the passing of a national culture of, and there's just a lot of people who don't like that, and I can't really relate to it, especially their children are drifting away from them. They can't talk to their children anymore. This comes up. So I just wondered, what do the two of you think about the relative importance of these two meta-theories?
Well, Thomas Frank's What's the Matter with Kansas is the place to start. I think that it's harder to talk sense to people whose lives are slipping out of their control. I also think that culture and political economy move at different paces. Cultural shifts are slow and molecular. Changing people's minds is very hard. Max Planck, the great physicist, said that physics progresses one funeral at a time. Well, it's something like that is how cultures change. People with old ideas don't so much change their mind as disappear. But institutional changes, like the deindustrialization of America and can happen very quickly. NAFTA, 10 years after NAFTA in the mid-90s, tens of millions of Mexican farmers had lost their ability to support themselves and were headed north, and tens of millions of American workers had lost their jobs, and a great many investment banks and international corporations were doing fabulously well as a result. But of course people live on both of these time frames, in both of these realms at the same time, and both are part of our common life and need to be talked about. And I think even the deplorable, even the people with deplorable opinions and attitudes can be talked to by, you know, politicians who are talking straight. I mean, politicians don't talk straight. Bernie Sanders talked pretty straight. Elizabeth Warren does. You know, they're pretty rare. The gaffe is, as someone once said, when a politician tells the truth without meaning to. Every word that, at least at the level of presidential candidates, comes out of their mouth is filtered through layers of political consultants and focus groups. And people sense that. People sense they're not being treated as, you know, as part of a, just as equals. And anyway, so I think both things about rights and rights and beliefs have to be talked about, and institutions and policies also need to be talked about, and I think they can be easier said than done.
I don't have much to add. Others?
Oscar, and then I'll come to you. So I have been urging friends to read this book, especially for those first four essays, which someone's prophetic soul, I don't know whether it was yours, George, or Bill's,
no, George,
put together in such a way that really clarifies why what happened. We have the Electoral College in the first essay. We have the disinterest in democracy that you discuss in the second essay. In the fourth essay, Marshall Berman's piece, we get a sense of who the American public is, that 70% of them believe in aliens, etc. The third essay about Michael Albert's economic theories is really interesting and a surprise in that grouping. So I'd love to hear from both of you, from you, George, about Albert's essay, about his economic ideas, and from you, Mr. Kennedy, about the likelihood of the Electoral College sort of actually evaporating.
How did you take that first?
The Electoral College is not going to evaporate. There are too many interests, powerful interests. I mean, look at the last election. It's not, the Electoral College is not going anywhere. And we have a constitution that it's very difficult to change it. I think that one of the things that needs to be done is we need to we still have a cult of the Constitution. We still have all too many people who go around thinking that the American Constitution is just, you know, the greatest thing. I would urge people in here to read Sanford Levinson's The Undemocratic Constitution. Sanford Levinson, for the last decade has been going on and on and on about the need for people to take a good, hard, close, critical look at the Constitution. And he talks about the way in which the Constitution is a problem, a terrible problem, that people don't pay enough attention to. He wished and he urged, for instance, Bernie Sanders to talk more about the Constitution. It is in our way. And, it really is a huge problem. We can start with the Electoral College, but we don't have to end with the Electoral College. I don't see the Electoral College going anyplace soon, unfortunately.
Neither will the Constitution, though.
Noel? Yeah, and we've got our thinking I mean, education. I mean, you talk about you know, things to do. Just the low level of just basic information in the citizenry, which I don't think is accidental. You know, Trump talked about, yeah, he liked the lowly educated. Yeah, for good reason. But it's not just people who don't have much education. You know, we go around having all sorts of ideas. One thing that it seems to me that maybe we need to do in this current, you know, in the next few years, we need to really push and be, and at every point, demand more clarity. So, for instance, these nominations are going to come up. I'm thinking particularly, I'm a lawyer, I'm thinking particularly about the courts. Already, Senator Schumer said, you know, we're going to be really tough, we're going to really look closely at the nominees, and we're not going to accept, and then his, you know, he says, you know, nominees who are out of the mainstream. It makes me want to shout, hey, listen, cut with the out of the mainstream business. Scalia was in the mainstream. The Chief Justice is in the mainstream. The mainstream is polluted. The mainstream is a problem. Be more clear in saying what you don't want and what you do want. And don't be so dilly-dally-ish. So, you know, in our camp, we have people who sort of throw, you know, are disparaging towards, for instance, the Tea Party people. Well, those are the people who, you know, demand litmus tests. Damn it, we should demand a litmus test. What do you mean? We have litmus tests, but we're afraid to state them. You know, I don't want anybody who's for slavery. I don't want anybody who's for segregation. I don't want anybody who's a sexist. Those should be litmus tests. We shouldn't run away from litmus tests. We should be much more clear, straightforward in talking about what we want. And I think you're right in saying, actually, instead of constantly, you know, laughing at and just sort of looking down upon, you know, the Tea Party people and the people on the right, at the level of just plain fighting, you know, in terms of propaganda, in terms of just plain politics, we can learn a good deal from them. And, you know, we should snatch some of what they've done and put it to good progressive use, as far as I'm concerned. I went on longer than I thought. I'm sorry.
George, that third essay, the Michael Albright economics.
Oh, it's the book that I was talking about is called Looking Forward. It's a play on a great 19th century utopian novel, Looking Backward. It's a thought experiment on how to design an economy and society without excessive inequality or hierarchy, without wasting people's lives and to the enormous extent that we do now. Actually, it got no traction in the mainstream, but it's very popular on the American left, and Michael Albert is the author. I encourage you to check it out. It's semi-plausible. It involves going to an awful lot of meetings, community meetings, workplace meetings, and you know, it may very well be that it will only be possible if some future generation is socialized into liking going to meetings. And but it's very, you know, it's very provoking and worthy. Right now, things are so dark that although utopia and moral progress and political progress are one of my sort of pet themes, and I just don't have the heart to think about utopias even as a form of intellectual play. The tasks of the moment just seem too desperately urgent.
You got it.
I have one comment, one question. First, you said at some point that social change only happens.
Can you speak louder, please?
Sorry, yeah, I have one comment and one question. The first is that you said at some point that social change only happens at the level of funerals, to put it quickly. But in my lifetime, there's been a massive social change in the case of gay rights, which happened in the span of 5 years or 10 years. It seems to hit me out of nowhere. I mean, they wasn't following it very closely. But all of a sudden, you know, we went from 30% of Americans saying being in favor of gay marriage, which I think is a reasonable litmus for generally being in favor of gay rights, to 60% of Americans being in favor. And suddenly, the leading politician in the Democratic Party were in favor. And so it's clear that sometimes there are these social movements where suddenly a bunch of people change their minds, who seemingly were set themselves. And then the question I had for you was about something you were saying earlier. You were suggesting that the left might be able to develop the same kind of revolutionary fervor and grit as the Tea Party has, and use this as a model for action. And I guess I was wondering for you, I mean, it seems to me as a leftist who was following politics very closely as previous cycle, that the left had a problem in that it had no money behind it, it had no powerful interest behind it. The Tea Party philosophy and politics seem to be completely not incompatible with the interests of the oligarchy and the interests of the establishment. Moneyed interests have gone against the Tea Party. They have supported Tea Party people. I mean, I first heard of the Tea Party from an op-ed from Newt Gingrich in the Washington Post. I thought, what the hell is this guy smoking? You know, who is this group? He was right. You know, it's easy to say. Anyway, I was just wondering whether you could think of some way that the left could tap into resources, into both media resources and economic resources, and actually get the kind of traction that really has.
Yes. Good question. What I meant to do with that comment was about funerals, was decompose social change into economic on the one hand and cultural on the other. It's cultural change that I think happens glacially, very slowly. And I think actually gay rights is a good case in point. The institutional changes came very quickly. And they came for the same reason that feminism actually happened very quickly over a few decades. And it's because the logic of neoliberalism is very much anti-discrimination. It's not economically rational to discriminate, so elites have no genuine interest in. However, the institutional change was not accompanied by as we see from all of these riled up Trump voters, was not accompanied by a change of heart, a change of belief, a change in the culture of the moral culture of the country. And that's where the backlash came from. Doesn't mean we should stop pushing for institutional change necessarily, but have to recognize that it's not over once we've changed the laws. We still have to change the hearts and the culture of our fellow citizens. As for how to attract, how to get traction, the Tea Party started out as just a lot of angry suburban, usually, people. And first it got, you know, it started taking over, mayoralties and school, cities councils and school committees, and then state legislators. And then the billionaires, you know, noticed and started pouring money into it because it is, as you say, suits them, their book, just fine. I think, and this is what I meant about starting organizations, however local and primitive and humble, once something has demonstrated, once you can demonstrate a certain level of savvy and dedication to left-wing billionaires or centrist billionaires, and there are a few of them. As a matter of fact, Ralph Nader wrote a whole book about how 17 billionaires and celebrities could turn American culture around. It was called Only the Super Rich Can Save Us. It's really a very smart and useful book. But if you want to get money from rich people, you don't go to them with an idea. You go to them with an organization, with some track record that proves you're serious. And then you'll at least get to talk with them.
What do they get out of it, though?
Well, just because they don't need to make any more money. George Soros, you know, doesn't need any more. And yeah. Is he a reasonable?
He seems to fund a lot of progressive causes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure.
And he's got an awful lot of money.
Yeah, well. But I'll come to you, but let me get to say it.
I'd like to get the speaker's reactions to a more strategic approach to this. Namely, I think there's a sort of a short game and a long game. And a lot of what we've been talking about here is the short game, you know, who's going to get appointed to what. And that is a fight that is worth having, much of which will probably be lost, based on where we are today. The long game is the complete deterioration of the educational system in this country, because a democracy requires an informed electorate. And I think that in getting emotional, and I have to disagree about the mainstream is the price you pay for being in a democracy. And you have to have an educated mainstream. Maybe it's a semantic difference we're having here, but we have to accept that. If we don't like it, that's just too bad.
And your question?
My question is, can we differentiate here between short-range goals and a longer-range societal change?
Randy, take that just
on the question of mainstream, I think it was a semantic thing. Mainstream in quotation marks. Your earlier your question, I'll respond to it by citing and reading from George. This is an essay that he wrote in 2007. If we want a durably decent society, we have to improve the quality of political discussion. How to accomplish it? I don't know. Perhaps population exchanges between blue and red states. Perhaps pairs of leftists and rightists, Katha Pollitt and Ann Coulter, Thomas Frank and David Brooks, Greg Palast and Matt Drudge, could barnstorm the country debating before large and partisan crowds, the way public figures did in the 19th century. Perhaps secular liberals should go to church and distribute copies of The Nation to their fellow churchgoers. Somehow or other, someone or other must sow a healthy appetite for informed, discriminating political argument across large swaths of the electorate where it now appears lacking. Otherwise, public life will become wholly what it is now largely, a marketing competition and nothing more.
He said it. Yes, dear.
Yeah, I just have a comment going back to what can we do and what organizations. What about the Democratic Party that has so abandoned local politics? Why do the Republicans have 31 governors and 29 state legislatures? And, you know, apart from moving away from our core values, we've moved away from our organizations and from putting our energy and effort. Just look at 2000. Look at the power that Catherine Harris had as Secretary of State in Florida. Look at the power that Ken Blackwell had as Secretary of State in Ohio in 2004. And I think this is where the Democratic Party has really, really left us in the lurch here.
Right.
And I think that's really something we need to look at. And I have to say about Hillary Clinton's campaign, yeah, I've been in politics for over 60 years as an elected legislator and very active and involved. I have never heard a politician diss voters before. And I don't know what genius she paid to come up with Basket of Deplorables, but, you know, there are a lot of mistakes made in this Democratic campaign.
Yes. A million or so people voted for Jill Stein, the candidate of the Green Party. I actually am a member of the Green Party. If that million people, if there were a million activists around the country trying to turn the Democratic Party around, maybe that would be a better use, will be a better use if I ever have the ear of any other Green Party members. Otherwise, I don't know, but ordinary people have to get the idea that this is what we have to do.
Two more from the audience.
Yes.
Up on the DNC. The DNC is one of the most corrupt institutions in America, and it has no interest in learning about what's going on in Ohio. Others have written more intelligently about this, but my point really is, and following up on your thing, that unless massive energies are focused not just on local issues, which are certainly important, but unless some kind of protests or effective critiques of the DNC are made, there's an election coming up in February, a new chair is going to be elected, and it's going to be a done deal before you know it. From the little I read, and I don't read much, my stomach won't take it, it appears that the people who control the DNC are more or less feel everything is fine, the Clintons and all the rest of them. I don't blame at all the Clintons.
She's getting ready to run again.
Yeah, so I just point out that at some level, I think we do need to prioritize certain kinds of things. And for me, the DNC is a major, major issue right now, even though it can't be done in a hurry.
Let's end on another question. Somebody, please. Yes. We're
behind. Well, everyone likes to say that we are all in our bubbles now, you know, and especially up in Massachusetts, New York, the cities, we're in a city bubble. And, you know, maybe on social media we are in a bubble, but I don't think we're in as much of a bubble as we think we are. You know, I was working all through this election downtown Boston in a pharmaceutical company, and there were Trump supporters at work. And it was sort of funny at first, you know, back in March, we would dismiss, oh, you really would vote for Trump? Well, that's okay, he won't win. And then it got serious. And everyone said, you know, you just can't talk about it because we're at work. And it's certainly possible to organize 5 hours a week, but most people spend most of their time, 40 hours a week or longer, at work. And we've created such a culture where you can't discuss politics even when it becomes really serious, even when you have a gay coworker who's supporting Trump and Pence. And you want to have that sort of long intellectual discussion where, you know, you provide points on why that might be an issue to you, or why it's an issue to you when somebody you go to work with is supporting someone who's so sexist and wants to bring us back to the Mad Men days. You know, how do we change that? Because the greatest possibility of meeting other people whom we respect enough to have a long conversation with that could begin this, you know, the seed of changing somebody's mind. How do we change that sort of rule that we don't discuss serious things like really serious politics at work, where we spend, you know, most of our lives for many of us?
I guess you start by challenging it.
Was talking about the Rust Belt, and he was basically jeered out of here. This is the sort of thing.
I don't think he was jeered.
Well, you started lashing out at him, calling him basically a racist, etc.
I did not hear anybody say that. I disagreed with them. We can disagree.
Well, okay, you said they are baskets of deplorables.
Yeah, they're deplorable. Yes, and I say that to you.
Okay, that's not what I call a conversation.
What? Saying that somebody has a deplorable view? Why is that not a conversation?
Well, it didn't seem like you engaged him at all.
I'm sorry to see the guy leave.
I mean, I don't feel like...
I found that absolutely emblematic of the kind of conversation I've heard in Cambridge. People so dismissive of people, you know, who are economically on their uppers and just acting like that they have, you know, that they're a basket of deplorables.
I think that on this one, you know, it's funny, if you want to have a conversation,
right,
you have to have a conversation.
Right.
That fellow, as far as I'm concerned, you know, what he was saying to me was, he said, well, you know, I mean, people weren't paying attention to these people who were really down and out. They were paying attention to, and then he suggested, marginal things that don't matter.
Party was saying to him that he should be worried about bathrooms rather than his job.
No, he was saying, Catherine, be fair to the man. He was saying that he'd been throughout that part of the country. We hadn't been there, and he was speaking for all of those people. And I find that not, you're not going to have an argument with somebody who tells you he's speaking for all those people. Plus, he voted with his feet. Did he vote with his feet because he was jeered out of here? I don't think I heard any jeering. But basically, he was talking for everybody. I think that's how can we have, I mean, have we really bought the fiction that there is another world out there that we are not a part of, and that they are immoral people and so on, and they only care for themselves, which is basically what he's saying, and we don't care for them?
Is that untrue?
Yeah, I think it's untrue.
But that's
absolutely.
The big question. That is the big question. I'm not
saying
it's true.
Of course,
sure
it's a big question, but I think it's untrue, sure, because one of the things that Randy pointed out to him is, if that's true, you chose the wrong guy. Do you really think Trump's going to bring back steel to Scranton, Pennsylvania?
Don't. He said nothing about Trump at all.
No,
he
but,
said the Democratic
I,
Party had.
No, but no. He's. But he was talking about his. He had been through the Rust Belt, and
right.
That's what he had learned from all of these people that he made into a mass, and that's what they were telling him, and we weren't listening. I'm tired of being told that I wasn't listening. For Christ's sake, I live in New York. I am who I am. I'm not asking them to come and listen to me, and I'm being told that he is speaking for all of these people. We're not speaking for anybody, I think, tonight, but ourselves in trying to make that case. He could have stayed here, he could have listened, but the point is, and I'm back to Randy's point, that if you say everything he said was true, do we believe for a minute that they chose wisely? And do we believe for a minute that Hillary Clinton's off-the-cuff remark about deplorables, as disgusting as that may be, has anything to do with the kind of comments that our current president, or our soon-to-be president, was allowed to make?
Because he didn't talk about our president. Let's just not let it smear into that. He was talking
about... Randy did ask him a question. But so what do you do?
Yeah.
And he had nothing to say to that.
And he walked
and he left. But it was a conversation. He was asking a perfectly reasonable question.
Sorry, I got lit up.
Hold it. Stick with it, Captain.
I'm perfectly... Do we have time, or do we have to cut?
Yeah,
we gotta cut.
Yeah, it's. I think we have to wrap
sure,
up.
Sure, hold it.
Let me
last word for our writer. I'm gonna give you the last word, but I first of all want to say something about this book that no reviewer has said yet, but as its publisher and one of its early readers, I said that. For years, George has always thought that he wrote these wonderful essays and so on. He wondered if they cohered. Is anybody going to be really interested? Well, we found out by publishing them that people are interested, and they are terrific essays. This book is different, because this book has a theme. This book has a thread that runs through it. He means it about income equality, and originally what he wanted to do, but our designer protested, is put graphs all over the cover about income equality. It's got a thread through it, and if you want to follow this man's thinking, there is a thread. These are not simply standalone essays. That's what I wanted to say to you. Now please get the last word.
Anticlimax, but... Well, people who are, you know, on their back foot, people who are, you know, if you know somebody who's in a bad way, who's confused and desperate and behind the eight ball, and who says something stupid or many stupid things, you cut him and her a little slack. It doesn't mean that you moderate your opposition to whatever policies are up for adjudication. You fight just as hard to get whatever anti-discrimination provision is in question. But you also talk to people where they are. I know Randy Kennedy does this. That's my last word.
Thank you.